Well, thank you very much. It's great to be with you. I appreciate each of you being here. I know that there's a lot of things to do in the summer, and Young America's Foundation certainly is delighted to have you participate in our programs. Hopefully, for those of you that are here for the first time, which is a majority of you, you always will feel comfortable coming back and utilizing the full gamut of services of the foundation, which includes not only the Young Americans for Freedom chapter organization, the core Young Americans Foundation programs, the Reagan Ranch, and our National Journalism Center. So I'm the old man of the organization. I am responsible probably for raising money first and foremost to keep the organization moving forward. So sometimes when people ask me what I do for a living, I say I earn money the old-fashioned way. I beg for it. So that's a big part of my job. But it also has been to set the direction of the foundation, certainly some of our core programs. And it's accurate to say that after working with President Reagan, Ronald Reagan initially, but then President Reagan for a number of years, that I got the ball rolling on saving the Reagan Ranch, which was just a wonderful opportunity. Ronald Reagan was a huge influence in the lives of so many people in our country, particularly young people. But of course, as President of the United States and even as Governor of California, profoundly influencing the ideas that people have of the conservative movement. Those people that lived through the Reagan years, Reagan personified conservatism. And that was a very healthy thing. He was under heavy attack. He was mischaracterized many times. But at the end of the day, people knew that Ronald Reagan represented the modern day conservative movement. And those people that lived through either his gubernatorial years here in California or his 8 years as President of the United States, they had the opportunity to understand conservative principles by probably the best spokesman for those principles that the conservative movement ever had. I'm so pleased you took time to sift through what those principles are, because they're absolutely essential for you both to understand your own principles and then to understand how they match up with the conservative movement principles so you can advance our ideas, because they will not be advanced otherwise. And there'll be examples that I will give you. I'll give you some of the current media, but certainly it was underscored last night by Rachel Campus Duffy, how President Trump has found a way to communicate directly with the American people through Twitter and through other means of social media. He's actually used that probably more aggressively, to be sure, than even addresses from the Oval Office or addresses in other presidential, normal presidential settings. So that has shifted, and we'll talk about how the general public perceives President Trump in a little bit. But I want to back up and share how first I became a conservative and why this particular program, the high school program, means so much to me, and why it's so important that it continues to grow if Young America's Foundation is going to offer the kind of assistance, the kind of help in building the conservative movement, in building a free society throughout the 21st century, throughout your lifetime. I actually became a conservative when I was 16 years old. My grandparents came from Ireland. We had probably in the early 1960s a very traditional Irish American family, which meant that the Kennedys, the picture of President Kennedy was like a deity in our house. Eventually, Robert Kennedy became our senator. I grew up in upstate New York. So the Kennedys sort of personified at that time Irish American thinking. But what was the ideas or the principles that were underneath or were common denominator, at least in most of our family and certainly with other growing conservatives at the time? I certainly had a religious family. My parents and my grandparents were very religious. Certainly believed, of course, in the Ten Commandments. They were regular practitioners of their faith. Usually an important event in our house was a baptism, a first communion, a confirmation. Those type of things rallied the family together. There was also a love of country. My grandparents still stayed in touch. Our family did and still does with our relatives in Ireland. But we became Americans, to be sure, or the family became Americans, to be sure. So there was an underlying love of the country that was well tested in the late 60s during the Vietnam War. But you could contrast that also coming from an Irish heritage that was extremely skeptical of government. The Irish Catholics did not control government in their country for most of the prior 600 years, didn't when my grandparents left Ireland in 1911. And the idea of trusting the government was something foreign to our family. So this was some of the family background. And of course, we were very family oriented. So it was within that context, though, that I didn't view myself as a conservative. Most of the family, almost all the family, was Democrat. They all supported a Democratic president of the United States. I did work in my father's grocery store, which was in the inner city of Buffalo, New York. And so there was a lot of people that quickly realized, customers, that I was a reader. I often got criticized for reading when I was, quote, supposedly supposed to be working. And customers plied me with different books. I realized very early on, people from different political persuasions are very interested in what young people think and what ideas shape young people. But essentially, I grew up in a society with a great society. LBJ was elected president overwhelmingly in 1964. The country wasn't ready to have its third president in 11 months or so. The government was growing. And what really made me become a conservative was seeing not so much the promise of conservatism, but to see the failure of liberalism, a theme that has not directly been addressed as far as I can see so far in this conference. What was happening was looking at the inner city, the Great Society ripped down a number of homes. The parish that I went to elementary school with was not a pretty parish, but it was our homes, it was our community. The federal government came in and literally wiped out every single home in our parish, eventually years later to substitute some additional homes. Growing up at my father's store, I had the experience of government workers simply looking for handouts, even if they were inspectors, meat inspectors, scale inspectors, sign inspectors, garbage inspectors. They didn't inspect anything. They only inspected what was put in their hands. That was a thoroughly corrupt municipal government in Buffalo, New York. In fact, we had garbage pickup twice a week that was controlled by the government. And for my dad to have the garbage men take the stuff away, they're already paid full for their service. He had to give them a six-pack of beer and a carton of cigarettes. As a young person working for free, basically for my family, this grated on me. I wasn't a particularly big fan of this. But it came together for me when a high school teacher told me this guy, Bill Buckley, was a greater threat to the United States, and this was 1966, than Adolf Hitler was to Germany in the 1930s. And I didn't know anything about Bill Buckley at the time. But he had run for mayor in New York City in 1965, and he had written a book entitled The Unmaking of a Mayor, which was a lot of a collection of his speeches and his ideas criticizing the municipal government of New York City. And so I got the book expecting to be appalled, expecting to reinforce the views that my high school teacher who told me that had suggested. And when I started to read Bill Buckley's book, I said, I agree with everything this guy is writing, everything. I mean, it was just his analysis of the corruption of inner city government, the failure of government promises as government was exploding and claiming to solve so many problems, but was actually causing problems in the inner city, was just so obvious to me that I immediately was fascinated by what Bill Buckley had to offer. I was also influenced at that time by the quarterback of the Buffalo Bills, a quarterback named Jack Kemp. He had been prominent in the American Football League. He was the head of the American Football League Players Association, which eventually merged into the NFL and became part of the NFL. And he was headquartered in our neighborhood in a downtown hotel, the Players Association, and I continued. I did work for him, but he also urged me to get involved in Young Americans for Freedom. So you had a quarterback, sort of a hero to a football fan, as well as the founder of Young Americans for Freedom, Bill Buckley, being influences on me when I was 16 and 17 years old. And those were reinforced. Buckley, when I went to college in 1968, Bill Buckley came to our campus largely because his brother was running for the United States Senate on the conservative party line. For those of you that are not at all familiar with Bill Buckley, I guess the closest analogy I could give to you is he was the Ben Shapiro of his day. Very popular. Students came out in large numbers to hear him. He was considered to be a cutting edge intellect in many, many ways. And of course he was, just as Ben Shapiro is today. So the closest we have to a Ben Shapiro of today, when I was a high school student, was Bill Buckley. His brother again ran for Senate in 1970, where he actually was elected on the conservative party line. Bill Buckley came to our campus again at that time. Ronald Reagan ran for president in 1968. And my high school yearbook is filled with comments from other high school students. I'm too radical. Reagan will never become president. Reagan's a lousy actor. Most people forget that Reagan ran briefly for president in 1968. But eventually lost the nomination to Richard Nixon. He didn't run a full-scale race, but he ran in some of the primaries and then threw his head in the ring before the convention. And then eventually Jack Kemp, the quarterback that I was working for, ran for Congress when I was an undergraduate, and he got elected to Congress. And I went to Washington and served as an intern for him on Capitol Hill. Jack Kemp fits to this story for your purposes. Maybe old news, this is a name you're not familiar with, but when you were at the Reagan Ranch yesterday, I'm sure it was pointed out where Ronald Reagan signed the tax cut. Jack Kemp was the sponsor of that tax cut in the House of Representatives. He was the prime mover in the House where it had to begin to support Ronald Reagan's tax cut. So very much fits with the story of Ronald Reagan, just as Buckley fed into the Reagan campaign in 68 and eventually 1976 and 1980. I say this and I share this story because if I was to absorb what was in the popular culture at that time or in the political culture at that time, there was no way I would have become or identified as a conservative. If you go back to what I said my family's principles were, you probably identify those as largely conservative principles. Religious, love of country, skepticism of what government can do and big government, and family-oriented. But there were many pulls in the other direction. One of the points that Michael Barone made quite accurately about Irish Americans is since they were kept out of governing Ireland for so long, when they came to the United States in huge numbers, really beginning in the 1840s, they did everything they could to get control of municipal governments. And they did in Boston, Chicago, Buffalo, a lot of major cities. And in the Irish community, if you did not hire your own brother and sister, you were suddenly too uppity and you were a traitor to your family. And so the Irish that ran those cities became pretty much viewed by most Americans as very corrupt. But they were very good politicians. And that was true in Buffalo as well. So that is a part of the Irish culture that ran a little bit counter to ours because we were in a family business and we continued to view government most skeptically, even when it was run by Irishmen, and it was mostly Irish men in Buffalo, New York. So jumping ahead, why do I share that part of the story? I share it because I want to reinforce that it's the principles that's going to give you a chance to advance the idea of freedom, to advance our side, if you will, of the political culture. I think you may know that already, because you're not going to be assigned conservative books in most high school. You're not going to have a chance to see conservative movies in most cases. These points were already made by other speakers at this conference. You're not going to normally have someone like Brian Brenberg who's going to say, you know, what has contributed most to your life and where did it come from and why were profits good? Those aren't ideas that you're likely to come across in high school, and I guarantee you, with a few minor exceptions in the country in terms of total student population, you're definitely not going to come across it in college. So my point, really heavily emphasized, is you're not going to become a conservative by looking at the personalities or what people say about personalities. You have to take that as a given. If someone's advancing conservative principles, that person's going to be vilified by the mainline news media. And you're going to have to overcome that if you want to turn to other students and urge them to consider your ideas. That's why the principles are so absolutely vital. Because the personalities, the left so controls the culture that conservative personalities are always going to be portrayed negatively, or almost always. I'll give you some exceptions. But let me give you examples of what I mean. People sometimes say, that's a bold statement. How do you back it up? You may get most of your ideas from social media and not from the main news media. But the average American still receives it. Your teachers probably do. Your parents probably do. Other people in our society from the major news media. This is why President Trump takes aim at fake news and at the news media. Well, how does the news media portray liberals and liberal ideas and liberal causes versus conservative ideas, conservative principles, conservative causes, but especially conservative individuals? So let me give you some examples. Let's start with the left. Who's afraid of Warren or Elizabeth Warren? This is a typical, very positive portrayal of a liberal politician. If you saw this issue on the newsstands, you would say there's nothing inappropriate by that. You know, it's not a, you know, necessarily a picture that makes you run out and want to spend time with Elizabeth Warren, but it's a positive one. This is more recently, and it was referenced, I think, by Rachel last night, that this is a person that says, I have a plan for everyone. One of the speakers previously said, I have a plan for something. That is what is her attraction in the Democratic circles right now. She has a plan for everything. Meaning, of course, she has a plan to run your life and tell you what to do. I like my own plan. People always said, do you like Obamacare? I say, I don't like Obamacare. I like Robinson Care. I like the things focused on what I want to have in a free society. We have an opportunity to do that. A guy who is a joke is Joe Biden, to be sure. I mean, there's so many examples of that, but this is an early example when he was vice president trying to resuscitate his reputation, saying he was no joke. So this is an older cover, but it again is very typical of how they will try to rehabilitate anyone who's been criticized on the left. This is a more recent, the test case, Boundaries in the Age of Trump. So again, a very positive cover, nice smile, nice suit, American flag in the lapel. The average person seeing this is going to have a positive view of him. Bernie, socialize America. Again, keep in mind that this is probably a positive image for most people. This is looks like a friendly grandfather, great smiling face, right? Relaxed, who wouldn't like this guy? That's basically what it's saying. He's a little bit older in the next one, but building a better Bernie on the road with a rebooted Sanders campaign. So they've dressed him up a little bit more. He looks a little bit more presidential. Nice smile, looking up, positive. You're going to see how President Trump's treated in a little bit, but I want to make a few other points along the way. Here's Mayor Pete with his husband, and a very, very positive cover. I'm sure Time didn't view that in any way critical. Of course, we had a lot of talk about AOC last night. She's becoming America's lightning rod, so maybe you can take that as not quite as positive, but she's changing the climate fight. She's getting a cover, weekly cover of the country's major news weekly. So again, pretty positive stuff. I understand why you laugh. That not only looks like a grandmother, that may look like a great grandmother. But that's the best they could do with Justice Ginsburg. But the left is doing everything they can to make Justice Ginsburg feel important, feel essential to the country. They obviously want her to stay on the Supreme Court, even though she's in her late 80s and has been in ill health. The left is doing everything they can to encourage her to stay on the Supreme Court so President Trump does not have another Supreme Court nomination. Nancy Pelosi. That's not the Nancy Pelosi I see on the news most of the time. Doesn't look quite like that. Again, a beautiful American flag, nicely made up. I'm going to try to be kind here. Again, the liberal Supreme Court justices are always portrayed positively when they're nominated, when they're on the court. Justice Sotomayor just voted to ban the commemoration in Bladensburg outside of Washington for World War I veterans because it's partially a cross in the, but very definitely a radical justice. This is, of course, testimony, the lasting impact. They've always portrayed people who come forward with liberal causes in a very positive light. The Avengers, this is first they marched, now they're running. These are people running for Congress. These were liberal Democrats running for the House and Senate to replace Republican men. So certainly time along the way did what they could to bolster those campaigns. I don't know precisely what they were avenging. The silence breakers, the voices that launched a movement. So again, that was the person of the year. Ripped apart, this is at the border. So they try to portray what the president's doing, not as the families that decide to come separately, not people that are coming illegally, but this is the cost of immigration crackdown. Probably the only time that the major news media really is concerned about family life and family values. But they definitely will portray it in this particular example. This is still within, this could have been on the conservative side, but I'm still giving you examples of liberals promoting their cause. What changed? That's Justice Clarence Thomas in the backdrop with now Justice Kavanaugh in the front. Basically trying to vilify both of them simultaneously. These are environmental activists. This is the suit by high school students to basically end cars, buses, planes, just about everything else in the country. This is an older one, but it really gives you an idea what message they're trying to convey to your generation. We're all socialists now. We're all socialists now. So what's your problem? Why are you talking about capitalism? After the last election, they're basically showing I voted as pushing Trump out of the scene. The truth is we always would love to do better, but the conservatives did very well in the Senate. They actually kept House losses below historical losses, but you wouldn't get that impression by the way Time magazine's portraying this. Then you have the Democratic candidates for president, with Trump looking very nervous at the bottom. Wouldn't overread this one in particular, but again, it's an example. Well, let's shift, if I may, to how the president's treated. How's this? Giving you the finger right there on the cover of Newsweek, the art of the bad deal. So. Couldn't start with a much more negative picture than that. Bully, showman, party crasher, demagogue. At that point, he hadn't checked off yet the 45th president of the United States. Obviously, this was designed to keep him from that. But as your fellow students, if you're trying to promote some of the ideas and some of the principles of Donald Trump, let's say the right to life principle, or let's say the idea that the person who earns the income should have the biggest say over how it's going to be spent, not a government bureaucrat, that you're trying to make those points, but they're looking at a person that's portrayed as a bully, a showman, a party crasher, a demagogue. Deal with it when he got elected. So that's probably, along with making him the person of the year, as favorable as gets. This is actually the most favorable, believe it or not. This is the person of the year, but it's an odd picture. They've never done the picture of the year with a person sitting away from the audience. But this is the most favorable we get. Every president who's been elected has usually got, or usually received, or usually been subject of a major positive cover of Time magazine. So this was the best that he got. Very quickly, that's Trump and Putin merged together. So very much suggesting that the president's working hand in hand with the Russians. This is a theme that we're going to see a lot of. There you go, the White House in collusion with the Kremlin. We later found there's no collusion. But of course, many Americans don't believe that because they've been pounded with these type of images for quite some time. Oh, jumping too far ahead. You have Trump. You have Trump's war on Washington, which I actually think is probably a good idea. But they portray him as breaking the Washington Monument. I don't view reforming Washington as bad, but so you can probably take that either way. First, you have nothing to see here. The first portrayal of the president very early on was that he really wasn't that interested in governing, that he was very light, and whatever people wanted to send him and do was fine with him, and that sort of portrayed that. But that image didn't exist for very long, so they went back with another cover, Stormy, you could either say the swamp is overwhelming him or the storm that he's put the country through. It's been tough having that high employment. It's been tough having great economic growth. It's been tough to make progress on a number of international fronts. Then the president's in over his head, in deep. You can see he's basically drowning in the Oval Office, not able really to be on his feet or do his job. The riskiest show on earth. So, if a liberal, like when Obama had a major initiative with Iran, that was never portrayed as risky. It was always portrayed as the peacemaker, someone trying to help world peace. Why he always bounces back? This must have been a tough admission for Time magazine, they did. Just singing the Trump reboot, what you can learn from this, Barr's next move. This is Trump being triumphant, if you will, because the initial reports that there was no collusion. In the campaign, they portrayed Trump first as meltdown. This was that he was going to lose the campaign. This was in the fall of 2016, but of course, they wanted to portray it as even worse, so then there was the total meltdown if he didn't get the message beforehand. Then you have your one. So you're getting the contrast pretty clearly. The wrecking crew, how Trump's cabinet is dismantling government as we know it. Again, just portraying as wrecking, not reforming, not turning power back over to the people. Impeachment. So that's what that is. That's a peach. Impeachment. See, get that? The art of the duel. They have him shooting tweets at Pelosi. Pelosi shooting subpoenas at the president. Of course, they always portray him as an egomaniac. King me, looking in the mirror, looking somewhat arrogant, to say the least. They doctored this picture, again, going back to the border. This is one of three doctored photos that Time has used. Welcome to America, making the president look impervious to this poor young child crying, looking for help. The hotel is a swamp hotel. How Trump's DC outpost became a dealmaker's paradise for diplomats, lobbyists, and insiders. So again, you get the general idea of what your fellow students see, absence of understanding or talking about conservative principles. Absence of that, they're going to view people like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders and AOC as these wonderful people, very positive. They're going to view not just, I use just the president here, I have a much longer presentation of when other conservatives are portrayed. Rush Limbaugh was portrayed on the cover three times, all very negatively. Pat Buchanan, who was Ronald Reagan's communication director, was portrayed as bully boy, preaching fear, and hellraiser. I could give you many other examples, but I think these are the ones that are recent, or at least dealing with recent figures. So, I underscore the point in showing this that you have to talk principles, and that's why your prior session was so absolutely critical, to understand those principles that fit with your life, fit with what you believe in. And so when you take someone last night like Rachel Campus Duffy talking about the child in her womb, if you believe that's a child, if you believe that's a human life that's worth protecting, you should be concerned about the 60 million lives that have been wiped out since 1973. Ronald Reagan, if you take the taxes, we talked about the tax cut. Ronald Reagan, I actually used part of it already in this speech. Ronald Reagan didn't just say he was for reducing taxes. Ronald Reagan usually had a three-point formula in conveying our ideas about taxes. He said, first, the person who earns the income should have the biggest say over how it's going to be spent. You as teenagers especially should know that. You probably got your first paycheck and was a little bit surprised at how much was taken out. But I can tell you, that's a lower percentage that will ever be taken out in your life, because as you earn more, government's going to take a larger percent. So if you're already surprised by how much it takes, buckle yourself in, because it's going to be much worse in the days ahead. So Ronald Reagan would say the person who's earned the money should have the largest say over how it's going to be spent. You or that person would spend the money more wisely than a bureaucrat in Sacramento or in Washington. And most Americans would agree with that principle as well. And he would therefore say, I'm for tax reduction. I'm for letting the earner keep more of their money. I want to wrap up by telling what I see, what I've seen operate in my lifetime, over my 50 years involved, and how it might apply to you. Because what I've seen in the conservative movement is a small group of people coming from unpredictable walks of life, that when they step forward to express our ideas, have unprecedented success. And I want to use five examples to underscore that, that related to the Reagan years. You're here to this weekend in part to study Ronald Reagan, in part to understand the movement that he led. And so while these examples are a little bit dated, they definitely fit within the context of the Reagan Revolution and some of what I've already said. And I studied what these people wanted to be when they were your age. These were all individuals that had a very big influence on our country in the subsequent years. The first was a photographer who wanted to become a Marine and did become a Marine. He was a minority black person in New York City, and he became a photographer for the Marines as well. The second person I have in mind was a jock who exercised all the time, was criticized by his classmates both in high school, down in LA, and eventually in college when he went to Occidental, as being just preoccupied by being a jock. The third person wanted to be, when he was your age, the promoter of the Kansas City sports teams, ideally the Kansas City Royals. The fourth person I had in mind when she was your age was a grocery store worker who admitted that she dreamed about Robert Kennedy and John Kennedy, for that matter. She came from an Irish-American family as well. And the fourth person, who when he was your age, wanted to be the manager of the sports department at Montgomery Ward. So these were people that came from unpredictable walks of life, that once they stepped forward, they had unprecedented success. But let me back up and tell you why I think the numbers are small, and then why they have success when they articulate our ideas, our principles. The numbers are small because the very essence of our movement and the very people attracted to our movement, if you go back and think about what you just answered in the questions about the principles that you believe in or the principles that the conservative movement believes in. It started with the idea, oftentimes, of family, limited government, individual responsibility, individuals leading their own lives, maybe forming their own businesses. Those are the kind of people attracted to our ideas. They're not people that want to go to a meeting every night of the week and tell you what your light bulb should be, or how much water should be in your toilet, or how you should spend someone else's money. These people that make up the conservative movement, who adhere basically to conservative principles, whether they know it yet or not, are the Leave Me Alone Coalition. They want to live their own lives. And you're going to have classmates that want to do that. You don't want to have to go to Kamala Harris or Dianne Feinstein to decide what music you want to listen to. You don't want to go to your local congressman to lobby what kind of band you can hear or what kind of concert you can go to. You want to make those choices for yourself. You don't want to just say, leave it up to democracy. You want to make an individual choice in that area. Those are the kind, you want the internet free. You want to be able to read what a Ben Shapiro has to say. You don't want someone censoring Ben Shapiro, so you don't even get a chance to make those decisions yourselves. So the people who come to our movement as activists is small. It's small because the very essence of our movement is leave me alone. And so when someone comes out of the shell, like the people I'm going to talk about, they do it despite their principles. They do it because they want to give a maximum freedom to other people that are involved. When they come out, they're generally from unpredictable walks of life. Because if you want to be president of the United States, like Bill Clinton did from a teenage day, you want to run the country, you want to be governor, you want to decide things for other people, decide how they should spend their money, rather than deciding how you should spend your own money, you're going to go to government. Bernie Sanders is an interesting guy. He's been a socialist all his life. Last year, his income was over $1 million. Bernie Sanders has 3 homes. You know, if you really believed in those principles, why doesn't he put the homeless in a couple of his homes? Why doesn't he share a greater portion of his $1 million income? Why doesn't he pay right now the tax levels that he's trying to impose on everyone else? He believes in big government. Go ahead and pay that tax level. When it was raised in his town hall on Fox, he ducked that question as fast as he could. So liberals want to run other people's lives. They want to go to meetings. They want to decide things for other people. Conservatives want to do it themselves. So the number of people that are activists on our side are more restricted. The number of people who are activists and want to go to meetings and do those type of things, that's the very essence of what we're up against. They want to run your life. They want to make those decisions for you. But yet, when they do step forward, they have unprecedented success because most Americans think like you, even most of your classmates, whether you know it yet or not. And the examples I give go back to the Reagan Revolution. That photographer was Thomas Sowell. You might not know him yet, and he's not in the list of books we recommended. They're probably books you want to look at more when you're a college student and you've absorbed a little bit more of the conservative philosophy. But his intellectual writings fueled the Reagan Revolution. And he's a professor now in his late 80s, early 90s at Stanford. Doesn't do much public speaking any longer, but he was a huge influence in the Reagan years. The jock was Jack Kemp. Jack, I already mentioned, brought forth the tax bill that Reagan signed at the ranch. He was from LA. His family was a trucking company, but he went to Occidental. He became quarterback of initially the San Diego, the LA Chargers, then the San Diego Chargers, and eventually the Buffalo Bills. The person who wanted to be the Kansas City sports promoter, he wasn't directly involved in the Reagan Revolution, but he popularized it afterwards. He became the country's leading radio personality beginning about 1989. That's Rush Limbaugh. The grocery store worker who dreamed of Bobby Kennedy but didn't like how much government was taken out of her paycheck, She became the leading speechwriter of the Reagan Revolution. That's Peggy Noonan. She's now a columnist for the Wall Street Journal. And she wrote some of her best speeches for the person who wanted to be the manager of the sports department at Montgomery Ward. And that, of course, was President Reagan. And these are individuals that didn't come from predictable walks of life, but they played a huge part of our movement. If you think about Donald Trump, he fits this description. He's an individual that never ran for a government office before. He was the first person elected president of the United States that had never done that, right? Gone right to the presidency. When he was your age, he wanted to be involved in his dad's real estate business, which of course is what he did most of his life, heavily criticized. He outdid his dad, but he was criticized that his dad helped him. My point to you is our movement's made up of a small group of people, not activists per se, but the number of activists that come out and advance our ideas is relatively small. But when they step forward, the country rallies around them. They did their job of learning their ideas, articulating the principles they believed in, and then they had unprecedented success. You can have that success. You can be that person. You might not think it's logical that in the years to come, you could lead our country, you could lead the conservative movement, but that's the way our movement has been. And that's the message I wanted to leave with you this morning. Thank you very much.